You are here to witness the pitches that our teams have been working on since yesterday. We are very, very excited to have come to this point. It has been an interesting weekend. We've shared so much, and we just can't wait to listen to what they've come up with. So during the next couple of minutes, we're going to have the pitches. Then we're going to have next step discussions, and this is going to be internally only with the teams. And finally, we're going to have the announcement of the winners and the wrap-up of the weekend. Before we begin, I am pleased to present our judges. We have Jake Keel, EcoRed President. EcoRed is a business association whose objective is to facilitate the incorporation of a culture of social responsibility and sustainable development in the Dominican companies. EcoRed manages public economic development facing the sustainability of Dominican Republic. We also have Jeannie Hansen, President of Sostenibilidad 3R. Sostenibilidad 3R is an organization aimed to promote citizen awareness of the efficient use of resources and the proper management of waste in the Dominican Republic. Inka Matila, UNDP DR Resident Representative. UNDP, or United Nations Development Program, has been part of the United Nations system in the Dominican Republic since 1964. They worked helping to reduce poverty, inequalities, and inclusion, and they support countries to develop policies, leadership, and partnership capacities and strengthen their institutions, as well as build resilience in order to obtain concrete development results. Javier Fernandez, Nubi spokesperson. Nubi is the first private sector alliance for waste management integrated system and circular economy in the Dominican Republic. Karina Chess, CEO of Calla Energy and Grupo Chess Space Chairman. Chess Space has become the heart of the entrepreneurial community in the Dominican Republic, offering everyone partnership building opportunities and flexible workspaces from multiple locations throughout the Dominican Republic. They build strategic local and international partnerships with organizations that allow them to further their mission of fostering environmental sustainability, gender equality, and disruptive technologies. Also, we have Johan Nunez, Assistant Curator of the Dominican Republic National History Museum. He is an environmental researcher working on several conservation projects at the Dominican National Museum of Natural History. He has studied the impact of plastic waste on the local fauna and raises sustainability awareness through his magazine, Revista Tinglar. We are very, very happy to have you here. We are also excited to count with facilitators and experts from all over the world. And without further ado, let's begin with the pitches. Just to remind you, the judging criteria. There's 30% innovation. This is the framing of the problem based on unique insight that highlights an unaddressed tension or fiction. Does the idea directly address this tension in a creative way that others have not been able to do in the past? Impact potential, 30%. How much impact on the SDGs can the idea potentially have? Is the problem and idea clearly mapped to impact metrics, ensuring each element is purposeful in creating change? And is the idea scalable? Viability, 30%. Is the problem backed by real data or experiences? Can the idea solution be technically feasible and implementable? Is the business model robust and feasible? And performance, 10%. Can the team convince others to care about this problem, join their team, and support their ideas? Just as a reminder, you have 3 minutes, and you will be cut after the three-minute buzzer sounds. The judges have 4 minutes to ask questions and provide feedback. So I randomly selected the teams, the order the teams are going to speak. So I will just call you out. As soon as you have your presentation showing, if you have one, I'll start the timer and you have to begin speaking. So the first team up is going to be team three.
Okay, team three, here we are. I'll share my screen. let me know once you're seeing it.
Yes.
All good? Perfect.
Go on.
This is Pamela. She's 28 years old and she lives in Santo Domingo. She's interested in leading a more environmentally friendly life. But most of her waste ends up in landfills because she doesn't know what steps to take in order to have an impact. And she's not alone. 85% of young adults in the Dominican Republic are either interested or very interested in taking eco-friendly decisions. However, out of that same group, 82% doesn't know how much trash they're generating, and 67% of them doesn't even separate their trash. We are Eco Alliance. We want to provide a friendly and convenient way for young adults to get knowledge and information about responsible consumption and disposal, because every green decision counts. Today, we sent out a survey and we received 112 responses in 4 hours, showing the interest in this type of eco initiatives. The average ranking to download an app for eco advice was of 4.4 stars. People want to know where they can take their recyclables, where to find eco stores, and receive information about eco products.
That's why we decided to create an app that tells you where the recycle savings are near you and what eco products you have and you can buy on your hometown. Our apps work with a reward system that gives you points for recycling. So the more waste you recycle, the more points you get, so that you can change them with our eco-friendly stores. We also will offer a chat community where eco-friendly users can leave reviews on products and services and the experiences they've already had. And we plan to expand on other services such as restaurants and supermarkets so that people can find them also in our app.
Our app will be directly targeting a gap of knowledge where 88% of young adults don't even know where to find the closest recycling center to them. Our pilot program will be in Santo Domingo with young adults aged 20 to 29 that have mobile devices and that are interested in recycling, leaving us with a beachhead market of 85,000 people. We plan to then replicate this model in other cities and later on target other age groups. The app will be free for users and will obtain revenue from advertising fees for our eco services. We'll do our marketing through our partners and in social media to incentivize users to download our app. We expect a cost of $10,000 for app development fees. We have identified these potential partners in Santo Domingo, starting with collection centers and later on expanding to other green initiatives. Our team is composed of 6 talented and environmentally aware individuals. And we are Eco Alliance, the mobile app where every green decision counts. Thank you.
Great job. So now you have 4 minutes for questions, and I know that the judges are going to raise their hands, so I'll be aware if anyone wants to ask anything. The timer set for the judges.
I don't know where the raise your hand function is, but great presentation. I just had a couple thoughts/questions. One, when you're looking at some sort of reward system for people that participate, whether it's points or some kind of feature that they get, whether it's a uniform or something that goes along with the app, I think the idea of gamifying behavior is really interesting. It's something we've seen kinds of different games, but I think the one that jumps to mind for me is Swift. And I'm not sure if you heard of this, but it's a bicycling app and basically allows people, it creates this community of people to be able to bicycle at home and compete against each other. And as you get more points or more miles or more achievements, you continue to scale up in the game. And so it's gamifying, in this case, a good athletic behavior or, like exercising. So if you've thought about something where what the rewards would be for people inside the app, similar to Waze, where they, if you give recommendations in Waze, then it gives you some kind of point system. So if you thought about that, and then also, is there any thought of connecting this to other types of civic action? you know, because in this case, it's basically assuming that all environmental problems are caused by the consumer, but is there anything that you've thought of to link it to the companies or to politicians for good policies or some way to kind of hook other members of society into your app so that there's more sort of participation? These are just thinking out loud, but things you might want to think about.
Thank you, Jake. Do you guys have anything to answer?
Yes. So I believe one of my colleagues, they're asking me to go to a certain slide. Just one second. Okay. Diana?
Okay, so I'm gonna answer your question in the meantime. So in the first phase of the app, the reward would be that you could change your points for eco-friendly products. So what we plan to do is not precisely have an impact on, let's say, logistics within companies and how they produce, but rather give them a motivation and a platform where they can showcase the products to people who are interested in buying this kind of eco-friendly products, as well as helping recycling stations be more noticeable, because we did find this insight that people just don't know how to dispose their waste. But in the future, we do plan to have this kind of chart, or let's say timeline, where you can see, as an user, you will be able to see your progress. You can see here that we try to do that already by telling you how much you've recycled and the environmental impact you've had, or how much environmental impact you've reduced. So we could use that to kind of rank users to create this healthy competition and who is the one who reduced the most within the app, and create that community, like you said, that will support each other and will help each other and motivate each other to be more eco-friendly. Does that respond your
Thank answer? You.
And
yeah, Javier, another judge has a question.
Yeah, as you know, for there to be sustainability in any business, it has to be environmentally, socially, and obviously economically sustainable. Have you considered what the revenue streams would be for this type of application? Would it be paid by users or by the stores, or how would it work?
So we did think about making it free for users, just that we get more downloads, especially since we're talking about 20 to 29 years old. It might be unlikely to pay for an app that gives you eco advice. But what we're thinking about is sort of Google ads, where you get certain ads at the top and it says ad, but you can pay or eco-friendly companies or, we would only support companies that are actually selling eco products. They would be able to pay to get that ad advertised, that ad space at the top.
Yeah, to add on that, our global vision is not just to have this little amount of, let's say, this a very close range of products, but to actually expand into services and startups that are trying to sell their products and to kind of charge them a fee for the products they sell through our app, as well as the ranking revenue that my partner just mentioned.
Thank you so much. Time is up. So much for answering the questions. And we go into team 10.
Thank you.
Can you hear me and see the person?
Yes. Perfect. Just give us a moment and I will let you know when you can begin.
Perfect.
Okay, so I believe we are ready for you.
Now? Can I start?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So we are the group number 10, integrated by Matthew, Celia, and me, Sayuris, and we are going to introduce you to Paco Pera. First, before jumping to our solution, we need to understand the problem we identify, which is related with the phone packaging, and how, on top of the phone packaging we already have in the cities, in the country, in the rivers, in the beaches, everywhere, on top of that, the government, as a state institution that should aim for alternatives that are greener, are buying and supporting that type of packaging to deliver the amount of food portions that is given to help during this COVID lockdown. This is an information that we took from Tinglar Media about our research that they did, in which they identified that 15 million of portions were delivered only in the last 5 months. We're talking about a big fish here. So we identified that we can work with a customer, which is the Directorate of Public Purchasing. And we identified that our buyer persona is gonna be main Carlos Pimentel, which is the general director, because he needs a cheap and hygienic method to distribute rations of freshly cooked food to vulnerable populations that complies with environmental agreement, because the method they have been using relies on foam, which cannot be recycled first, and second, ends up polluting our environment everywhere. So we identified that we have already existing alternatives in the country. We have Green Depot, which is part of the participants of this amazing hack. We have EcoEvents, we have Bioface, we have Ecolux, we have Bionature. We have many companies trying to aim for that type of green alternatives, but what are we supposed to do now? So we think that every time is better to do it together. And this is why we proposed as a solution, Paco Pera, which is a cooperative of green packaging companies in the Dominican Republic, to provide a real alternative to foam for food ration distribution. Why? Because being separated, they are not aiming for that big scale purchase that the government needs to be able to deliver. And what are they are gonna gain for this? They're gonna increase their sales, they are gonna standardize their process to be able to sell more, and the government is gonna be a change maker, is gonna step forward in the region, and is gonna do something to be with the real change the new government is talking about. Also, they're gonna reduce the cost on the waste management, and they're gonna be really being congruent with their signed international agreements and with the national strategy for development related to the SDGs. And thank you, so join us.
Awesome. I think Javier already raised his hand. Does that mean you have a question now, or is that?
Sorry, it was raised from the other presentation.
Okay.
It wasn't taken off.
Okay, Jake does have a question though.
How many companies are doing this kind of packaging currently, and what's the scalability of this cooperative? Like, is there any idea of how big this could get? Because right now the government seems to be one option, but there also seems like there are quite a few companies that also sort of struggle with the same problem of how do you serve food in remote locations using, you know, more sustainable packaging that's competitive. And the only way for it to be competitive is if there's more scale, right?
Yeah, that's an amazing question. We identify in the research that we did just today, 11 companies that are working with this type of green alternatives. And we did one survey, which was with Green Depot, which already let us know that he's been delivering already a month 250,000 of plates for food use. So we estimate that according to that, as an average, if they're together, even though we don't know in details the other capacity of the other companies, we can just create a standardized process to be able to sell up, to scale up, and to improve the quality of the product too.
Also, I would add to that answer that it's something that is needed regionally. So if you are talking about a scaling up, if it works in the Dominican Republic, this can be extended to the Caribbean because it's a similar problem in many other islands. So that could also be a scalable in that way.
Awesome, Celia. Thank you. Jenny has a question as well.
Yes. Very good. I really appreciate any suggestion that can be brought up to compensate for the use of foam, which is really littering our beaches. And I would suggest maybe including some lobbying for incentives and maybe compensating, because right now there's not a just competition between foam and eco packaging, because foam receives their raw material with incentive. You know, virgin material is very cheap. So maybe there has to be some kind of lobbying with customs so that, that these eco packaging can have some kind of incentives to compensate for the unjust competition that foam generates in the market.
Amazing feedback and input, Jenny. Thank you.
Thank you, Jenny. Inka has a question.
Thank you. Congratulations, team. Nice speech. My question actually, or comment or question, goes pretty much in line with what Jenny just said. From one side, have you thought how to sensibilize the people to use less foam? Because it's many, many times it's a question of not knowing of the alternatives on one hand. And on second hand, did you see the cost? Many, many private sector actors, tiny restaurants, they are claiming that alternatives for foam are very expensive. So did you do some kind of market research on the cost?
Yeah, what are you saying is a real problem. Like, we have a really huge gap in between the eco-friendly alternatives and the other ones because of the amount of their production. This is why we bring this cooperative model as the solution, because if they became together, then the costs are gonna go down and they're gonna be able to compete in better conditions. But also from the government's perspective, which is for now our main client, if they really want to put that sustainable purchasing and that SDG 12 and that change they're aiming as a even slogan of the new government, then this is an opportunity to become the leaders and to motivate the private sector to do the switch and to create the incentives for the good. Because what we have now is that the incentives are for the ones that don't need them anymore.
Thank you so much, Team 10. Next, we have Team 8, and while they get ready, the judges have a few minutes to put in their judging. Team 8.
Hey guys, what's up? I'm just looking for the presentation. Is it possible that we can share the screen of Nicole?
Yeah, go ahead.
Nicole, can you share?
Hey, I'm sorry, a minute. I'm on my way. Okay. Hi. Oh, wait. Okay.
And your timer is set.
Okay. So, hey guys, my name is Jochen, and together with Deborah, Eli, Nicole, and Porfirio, we discovered the app EasyCycle. EasyCycle will be effortless recycling system for everyone, which will be accessible and easy for people in the national districts. So did you know that 125,000 middle-class households, this is based on four people per household, are producing 550,000 kilograms of waste daily. This is based on numbers from the Vicepresidencia in 2017. And it says that every house, every person produces 1.1 kilograms of waste every day in the Dominican Republic. So the problem still exists because the current administration is not providing them an easy access to the corresponding waste management for which Dominican people deserve. So we came up with an idea. Next slide, please. So what is Easy Cycle? Imagine that you're at your home and you're waiting for the garbage truck to arrive. Doesn't show up. You have your recyclables, so you take them in your car. You have to drive all the way to the recycling center that maybe might be 2 kilometers away. So we've discovered an app. We're thinking of an app, which is Easy Cycle. Easy Cycle would not only be a tracking application, but will also be an application that you can have as a wallet. So imagine that every person that gets their recyclables picked up in their house receives credits for it. And they download our application. I'm sorry, I'm really nervous. and with those credits, they can achieve other, with those credits, they can achieve other, my goodness. Let me start over.
You got this, come on.
Okay, I'm here if you want help. Well, with this subscription, with the app subscription, they are gonna pay for the main service that is gonna be pickup, and we are gonna manage this as the Uber app manages their clients, right? So we have an app and we are gonna get a percentage for the pickup. And if you wanted a more complicated thing, when we can offer you a package, right? And the package can be for you as an individual person, paying monthly, annually, or paying with your neighbors if you live in a complex. So after we pick up your waste, then it goes to our recycling center, right? And what our recycling center does is it classifies and makes sure the waste is ready to be redirected to local industries that already work with recycling material. You can go, Hoshin. You got this.
Can you show me maybe the Miro mood board so I can go in there?
Of course. It's easier, yeah.
That's easier for me. So basically, application, pickup service, fast and easy. So that means that we're going to provide a service to pick up your recyclables at your home. That means also that people, for example, like Uber, imagine an Uber recycling, that people can apply with their own vehicle to pick up your waste and take it to our recycling center. Imagine that. Not only for those recyclables, you can get credits that you can use in our platform, but also companies.
<It's up>.
Yeah.
But don't worry, okay. I am sure the judges are gonna ask questions that are gonna guide you through finishing.
Okay, thank you.
So, do any of you have any questions? I don't see any hands raising. I can't see.
Okay.
I can raise my hand.
Karina raised her hand, and then Ginny. Go ahead, Karina.
Okay. So, great presentation. The images are really cool. So basically, this is an app where you have a team that where you can coordinate picking up your recyclables and taking them to your closest recycling center?
Yes.
Is that the route?
So what we basically want is we want to decentralize big recycling plants. We want to split up in smaller recycling plants throughout the national district so that people have closer access to their recycling centers. And with this application, you can either choose to geolocate your recycling center and go to your recycling center, or you can request a pickup. that can be done by us, or they can be done by an independent recycler that says, okay, I have a vehicle, I have no job, but I want to pick up your service. I want to pick up your recyclables. So he can get paid for this service, and he will take then the recyclables to our center, where the customer will receive credits for the amount of waste that he or she recycles. With those credits, we can allow them to, for example, to buy other stuff from companies or universities, because this was the actual goal of the application, is that people in the end, maybe, or youngsters, could maybe pay for their college tuition by recollecting trash. That we can work together with educational facilities to say, okay, we need a college tuition. What does it cost? How much trash do we need to recycle? And who can we make happy with a college tuition? So that children are incentivized. If they want to learn, you can pay for it, but with recyclables.
Thank you, Hojin. Ginny has a question or a comment?
Yes. Hi, Johan. Nice pitch. Have you thought of cost? What would this service cost?
Well, we thought about a general subscription to download the app. So that will be a fixed price. And then we would separate it into packages. So you can say, okay, I buy 50 pickups, I buy 100 pickups, I buy... And this obviously would go in grades together with free courses online. Maybe we can have a link with Coursera to offer a course in sustainability that you can buy with the cycle credits.
Okay, you know, it would be good for you to incorporate alliances with recycling industries. So go beyond recycling centers. And thereby, recycling industries could eventually pay for this service. It could be an income for the service. Mm-hmm. You see?
Yeah.
Because if you take it to recycling centers, these centers already have their own costs and benefits for their own, you know. But if you take them directly to the industries, they could eventually be your partner and pay you for that as well.
Well, what we wanted to do is we wanted to own the recycling centers, and that we are the recycling centers, so that recycling centers become more of a community space where people can go and share ideas, talk, maybe buy sustainable products with the credits, with trash that they go and take to the centers. Sort of a plastic bank, but not only for plastics, but also with aluminum and other recyclable materials.
Very nice. What, you're from Holland?
I'm from Belgium.
Belgium. Okay, very nice. Very nice idea. Thank you.
Thank you, Ginny. We also have Inka with her hand raised, and we have 1.5 minutes left.
Okay.
Just to compliment again Ginny's question, congratulations on the presentation. I would like you to profound a bit more about empowering the local communities. That's a very powerful idea. So basically, mm-hmm. what is basically the power of the communities here?
So the power of the community would be that we would empower them to create their own recycling business. We would empower them to get their own pickup service going. We would empower them to maybe even buy ways to create something else and offer their products in our store, where maybe they wouldn't have a platform, they wouldn't have a place to offer their products. But we in our recycling center, we would offer those products that people can buy from smaller entrepreneurs, for example.
Thank you.
Thank you, Johan. Now we have team 5, and while they set up, the judges have a few minutes to judge.
Can you guys see my screen?
Yes.
Okay.
I will let you know when you may begin.
Ashley? We're good?
Yes, you can. We can see the screen and I'll let you know when to begin.
Okay.
Okay, I think we are ready for you. Timer is set.
Hi, y'all. We're Cheese Consultancy, and we want to tackle single-use plastics inside major Dominican Republic grocery stores. So about us, we come from many different backgrounds. Two of us are located in DR, Janibel and Nicole. Putri comes from Indonesia, and last, I'm connecting from the U.S. Although we come from different backgrounds, we all see how imperative it is to address issues with single-use plastics. We know that plastics and other wastes are impacting the quality of life to those in DR. Currently, plastics account for 580 million pounds a year of waste in this country. While guided by the SDG goals, we decided to address the role of private businesses. We noticed that major grocery stores in DR have a need to implement plastic-less grocery packages specific to the grocery experience to comply with the new possible regulations, but still want to maximize the margin during the transformation to sustainability. As a result, we decided to propose the solution as a transition plan. Our main focus was ensuring, go back to the previous slide. Our main focus was ensuring our user feels in control of the transition process and that every change can be analyzed for its cost effectiveness. Our action plan is a step-by-step approach to change the environment of the stores progressively towards a plastic-free business. Our user will see value in the form of reduced risk of implementation, control of profit, improved brand imaging, and community engagement. Therefore, our approach is going to be broken down into four steps that could be carried out in the time span of about a year to 16 months. We are also taking into account the resources already available to our user because these are big grocery national businesses. Now the research is going to, we recognize that we must know the customer's needs and surveys can help the user gauge the specific timeline of implementation in certain locations. For partnerships, we want to empower local sustainable packaging producers through the economic of scale. For our education focus, by focusing on educating the staff about the new sustainable packaging, it will result in the employee buy-in and exchange of information with the customer. And now our last step, our business operative changes is, we're going to go ahead into the next slide. Because we understand that there is an investment from our user, but our step-by-step approach ensures that through this transition period, our grocery store will have revenue and still tackle the sustainability changes that it must adopt. Now, as you can see, we've located certain forms of revenue. We can go ahead and add, can you go back to the previous slide, sorry. So some of our direct revenue resources can be changes from sales in the deli and meat packaging, as well as sales from plastic bottles and cans. Now we have examples and a step-by-step guide available if you're interested. And for our possible users, please remember, control the change and you control the profit. And Team Cheese can support big grocers, be the innovators in these times. We thank you very much for your time.
Thank you so much, Team 5. We have a few minutes for questions. I know that Johan, Johanan raises.
Yes, very nice presentation. I really like the idea of including the education part, and it needs to be transversal because from top down to bottom, if all the employees and the communities invested in these themes because they are educated on it, I think that has way more impact than just trying to implement it at the business level. So cheers.
Thank you so much. Any of the other judges have any questions or comments?
Yeah, I'm not totally clear on the business model. How do you guys interact between both the providers of these single-use plastics and the supermarket? Like, where are you negotiating between these two entities, or where do you guys fit in?
Okay, so I'm going to try to answer. So our problem is that we have to replace the single-use plastic with a more sustainable packaging. And we realize that in the Dominican Republic, there's a lot of options of the sustainable packaging practices, and it is locally sourced. So we want to partner with them. So we can ask for them to partner with us, that we will buy from them in an economic of scale price. And then in returns, we can expose their products with the connection from our local chain. So to get more context, we will trying to target a big chain in Dominican Republic that is National, La Sirena, and I forgot the last one because I'm not from Dominican Republic. But with this case, I hope that the exposure of the product from the local producers can be like nationwide. And that's the transaction in values between the both parties. I hope that's answering your question.
Thank you. Any other judge want to ask a question or have a comment? Ginny is raising her hand. Go ahead.
I'm a little confused. And in order to appreciate your presentation, if I understand correctly, you will be buying those eco-friendly packaging to sponsor them and promote them beyond and with education, increase their sales. Is that it? Is that correct?
Yeah, to put it in short.
If I can cut in, we are putting the onus on the big business, right? We wanna make sure that we follow the SDG goals and values, and we incorporate private business into the future of sustainability. By presenting this program as a consultancy to the big grocer, we want to make sure that we produce a path of partnership between the big grocer and the local business that can supplement that need that the grocery stores might produce. We hope that they can work together in this sense. We want to incentivize both sides in order to produce a healthy relationship between.
So your profit would be like a middleman between buying the packaging and reselling it. Is that right?
Yes.
Have you thought of packageless, no packaging at all? And working with the business operation in promoting package-free?
Of course, but we wanna make sure that we introduce a multi-step process. Putri, if you can move to the next slide. So we wanna make sure that we produce a step-by-step guide. There is some hesitancy in big business right now to take that leap because they don't wanna just go from 0 to 60. So by producing a supplier of a compostable and or renewable source, we're producing a sort of safe start into the ultimate move to packageless grocery experiences.
I also want to add that sometimes the packageless is like reducing the shelf life. So it's not necessarily better to be packageless than providing with another alternatives of packaging as far as our research said.
Javier has a question and you have 1 minute left.
I agree that definitely certain packaging does extend a product life. The idea would be to find a more sustainable alternative. But there is definitely, as Jeannie says, some things that are just overdone, right? Some fruits come with their own packaging, the skins, right? And shouldn't be wrapped unnecessarily. Thank you.
Thank you all. Up next, we have Team 7. You can start getting ready, and I will let you know when to begin.
Yeah, that I'm ready. We're ready when you are.
Yes, I will let you know. I have a timer for the judges to finish judging. Okay, we are ready for you. Timer is set.
Hi guys, my name is Ted Gustafsson and our team is consisting of Mabel, Nicole and Odette and me, and we're Organic Chain. We tend to tackle an issue that is principally being overlooked by most in the business and is underestimated in the new waste law in the DR. So at the moment, the reality is that thousands of informal workers are making their living by going through the waste as it arrives in the landfill. They collect plastic, metal, glass, cardboard, textiles, and other materials that is later sold and introduced back into the value chain. And this is where the majority of the Dominican recycling takes place at the moment. More than 50% of the waste that arrives in the landfills today is organic. And the organic waste contaminates the recycled material and make it harder for the workers at the landfill to separate out the valuable raw material from the organic waste. Next slide, please. So it's not only the issue of the mixing and the contamination of the raw materials, it's also the major contributor. Organic waste is a major contributor of anaerobic methane through anaerobic digestion. It also creates heat and is a major contributor to the fire hazard at the landfills. Also, frequent fires has been recorded throughout almost every landfill in the country, and it's polluting the air. Methane is also one of the most potent greenhouse gases. It's 20% more potent as a greenhouse gas than CO2. It's also the main contributor to overcapacity in the landfills. And organic waste also contains a lot of moisture and liquid. And through leaching, it contaminates the local rivers and land with harmful bacteria and material. All of the above reasons create public health issues for the local communities surrounding the landfills, but also surrounding the regions surrounding the landfills. So we broke this down because it's a very big problem. So we decided to focus on 7 municipalities in the Grand Santo Domingo region, and together they're responsible for 3 million people and businesses. So they need a way to separate out the organic waste from other municipal solid waste at the source by ascribing value to it through regulation and create a functioning value chain. Because without regulations that incentivize waste separation of organics, the waste will continue to hold no value and create an environmental and public health issues at the landfills while also contaminating other raw materials that could have been recycled. So our solution is to create a private company that's acting as an intermediary between the public sector and the private sector in creating initiatives to create an organic waste value chain and incentives. And also we tend to make it easy for the sorting stakeholders, such as restaurants, et cetera, by providing the infrastructure at the place of generation, such as kitchen through the transport chain, but also through the production chain. One other idea we have is to utilizing big data and measuring the weight at each restaurant or place of generation to make sure that the collection is streamlined and effective through an optimized scheduling and routing. And feedback can also be sent back to the restaurant in order for them to monitor their own food waste and being able to limit that at source. Next slide, please. Initial stakeholders are the major contributors to food waste: restaurants, hotels, supermarkets, local markets, the bins that are placed at restaurants and hotels can act as a focal point where households can deposit their organic waste as well. So you can have them as local centers. We also spoke, so far we've spoken with one of the largest supermarket owners here, as well as restaurant owners. And the key insight is that it's, they're interested if it comes without investment, not a lot of extra cost, and some sort of incentive. Creating initiatives.
Sorry, time is up, but we have a few minutes for questions. So any of the judges want to ask any questions or have any comments? Inga.
Thank you. Congratulations. Very important thing. Basically, my question is just probably answered over here. It's basically what you are planning to do all the collected organic waste and how this is economically viable for the enterprise or private sector solution you are proposing.
It's twofolded, right? You need both some sort of incentive throughout the value chain, either being paid for collecting the waste as well, so you get paid for the raw material, but also in the other end, it will be through vermicide composting and biogas, depending on the municipality's local needs. For example, the outer regions of Santo Domingo might be more interested in generating fertilizer for the local farmers. But we also thought of biogas for more energy intensive places like Santo Domingo Center.
Thank you. Ginny, you have a question?
I have a question.
Jake, Ginny is first. She's in mute. After her, I'll give you the chance.
Ginny,
you're still, we can see you talking, but you're still in mute.
Okay. Can you hear me?
There you go.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Ted, nice presentation. You know, 60% of our waste in Santo Domingo is organic. So it's something very needed. But let me give you an idea. You know, around the Santo Domingo area, there's not much demand for organic compost. Like up north, where the plantains are, there is a lot of demand for that end product. So maybe there is more feasible economic-wise, that which you will be your end product will have a demand, a guaranteed demand.
Our majority, that's the vast majority of all the fertilizers is imported to the country. Mm-hmm. So there's not a lot of production here locally at all.
No, but the demand is not in Santo Domingo, but in the northwest, where the we have one of the biggest in the world plantations, banana plantations, which are organic, and cacao as well.
That's amazing.
But very good. I mean, I hope I wish you success.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ginny. We have Jake, and then we have Karina.
Yeah, along the similar lines, I think you address a very important problem because you're very strategically going after a huge volume of what is the waste problem in Dominican Republic. And most people are focusing very limited on, you know, very specifically on plastics, which is, you know, 10% of the waste stream, whereas, you know, as Ginny said, the organics are 60 or so. But the question is, what do you do with it and how do you pay for what it costs you to get it to that site? So if you're transforming it into compost, you know, what is the model that pays for that? Because you have to have these stations, you have to have education to get people to separate it, you have to move it all over the place, and then you have to bring it to the central site. And you've got two ideas here. You're talking about composting and biogas. Have you looked at other places that have done things similar, you know, ideas of either composting or biogas, and what the similarities would be to the Dominican Republic? Like in South Korea, they've done a lot of really good work with compost. Germany, they've done a lot of really good work with biogas. Have you looked at some of these other models and what might make more sense economically for the DR?
We have a system in my hometown, it's called Go Biogas in Gothenburg, Sweden, and they aggregate all the organic waste from households. In your house, you get a brown paper bag, and that you put in a separate bin down in your trash collection area. And that gets taken into becoming biogas and actually fueling all the buses and public transport in the city.
So but is that paid for by the city, or is that paid for by the government, or is that paid by?
It's subsidized by the government. It's incentivized by the government.
Okay. So in the DR, you would probably need some model that would, you know, compensate for that, because in the DR, it's unlikely there will be a subsidy. So there has to be some other way to create that, the economics of that.
One of the restaurant owners that we spoke to, he was so unhappy with the local service that he's paying for a private company to take care of his trash. He's actually paying above the other trash just to get rid of it, because it generates pests and other odors and stuff like that. So there is incentive for them to pay to get rid of the organic waste fast.
So it might be that part of your model is to be really strategically focused on large producers of organics and make contracts with them and provide them the service, as opposed to trying to do city collection or hotels or restaurants. Say, you know, we're only going to work with supermarkets, or we're going to be very specific with restaurants that are big volume producers or something like that. You might want to be pretty strategic about those decisions.
We spoke to one owner of a supermarket chain here, and he was interested. He said there's been other incentives in plastic and other ones, but never in organics, and it's quite easy for them to separate that out. But he said he would be interested if it doesn't come with a lot of effort and a lot of cost.
Thank you so much, and I know Karina is raising her hand. So Karina,
I'll be quick. I know we're out of time. Thanks. So yeah, one question was along those lines, how is this going to be paid for? So Jake pretty much went there. And the other one, Ted, you mentioned about using big data for measuring and predicting waste management. Can you, like a one-liner, tell us a little bit how you're going to implement big data? How are you thinking about this?
Yes, so the trucks itself comes with the weighing measures. If you can take that data point, you can actually see over time where. So you can maybe skip one day for a restaurant that generates less, and you can actually come up with the most optimized, fastest schedule that is the most energy efficient throughout the city. So and you can also provide that data back to the restaurant, see how many tons, and get their changing in, or the supermarket, and say how much have my waste gone down, and give them actual metrics back so they can improve on from their end also.
Great, thanks.
Thank you, Team 7. Up next, we have Team 1. Again, while you get ready, just have a few minutes to put in their judging. Team 1, we are ready for you. Timer is set.
Okay, thank you, Vivian. Good night, everybody. We are the eco-creation team made out of Laura Putondo, Laura Rosario, Dalia Susana, Irene Planchuelo, and Hamza Billy. We wanted to tackle the problem of the high amount of inorganic waste in Santo Domingo streets, and specifically, the foam contaminant. So we wanted to reduce the foam consumption, particularly in low-income communities in Santo Domingo. Why low-income communities? Mostly because these communities normally don't have options to don't consume foam, because foam is one of the cheapest options in the market when they go to the business in their community to eat something. Normally, that food is given in these foam containers. So we want to provide them with, we want to provide them with an alternative for them to be able to reduce their foam waste. So we want to give them access to affordable, practical, educational, and sustainable solutions so they can reduce their foam consumption, because this foam accumulates in the streets of Santo Domingo. And this is still an issue, because normally all of the actors in this problematic lack accountability on resolving the issues. Normally people say that the government should pick up the trash, and the government said that the people should be more educated and don't throw trash in the streets. So that's why we wanted to tackle the low-income consumers, so we can change their habits.
Irene? Yes, and after the team ideation process and based on our experience with local experts and low-income communities, we have developed eco-creation workshops, which could give employment for adults in low-income communities, as well as educational programs for children, by linking these communities with pre-existing plant-based companies in the Dominican Republic. So these entrepreneurs will lead the workshops, qualifying the adults of these communities to become their workers and reaching consumers in communities. You can see what we aim to. And I would like to say that these workshops are framed in a circular economy model, so that containers are made with natural local products, are produced locally, and are consumed locally. We will start showing this model with our business partners, which are the foamless containers producers, who hire low-income citizens that make and sell the containers to local businesses in their communities. This allows other citizens to collect the containers, process them as compost, and even sell it to other business partners that work with natural fertilizers and that could finance the first companies we talked about. You can see some images of the containers produced by the existing companies, and also pictures of other workshops about sustainability that have been already implemented. Finally, we would like to point that that eco-creation workshops target and are shown here. By encouraging women's economic autonomy, offering opportunities for low-income communities, reducing foam consumption, and developing sustainable solutions, and linking entrepreneurs with low-income communities. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Team One. Any of the judges have questions or comments? Okay, two hands raised, and we have Johanan first and then Javier.
I really like your idea, precisely because the low-income communities are the ones that have no choice. Because high-income communities and people that have had access to education already know they should be disposing properly of waste products, because they have the opportunity to learn about it. But people that have low income are at the very low end of the stick, to call it like that. So you can create jobs, further educate the population that needs it most. So great presentation.
Thank you,
Javier.
Sure. It's a great business model. I just had a few questions about financing. For example, you would educate and train certain community members to produce these more eco-friendly packaging products. Have you considered how they would finance that the equipment needed? Because it seems like you can produce it with a workshop, not necessarily a big manufacturing facility.
Yes. The idea that we have is that in this workshop, because it's a community, so we want to empower them. We are not able to maybe give them a lot of machinery. So these containers that we try to develop are containers that the business like the food businesses, small food businesses in the community can use. So it's produced locally and used locally. And that raw material and capabilities, we want to provide them through our business partners, which are those container producers already. And after they do that and they sell it to these businesses, when the business or the consumer have to dispose it again because it is made from biodegradable materials, this can be linked to another part of the of our business partners, which make compostables. So this will produce money, right? And that money will be reinjected in the business model to our business partners that are helping in the workshops with the machinery and with the raw material. So the money, the cycle of money, it never breaks and goes all around all the actors in that chain.
To add to that, this is a grassroots movement. There are a lot of companies that want to start producing material, containers, plates, cups, things like that in the Dominican Republic, but don't have the manpower to do it, even though they might have the press or have the idea. So in this way, not only do we help those startups, we help the communities. We give the communities job security, we train them for the future, and we also create a program. I'm not sure if you guys saw in in the slides that we talked about children programs. One of the things that we considered in this was while we're training the adults to create a sort of like a daycare during the training programs so that the adults don't feel that they have to leave their children at home and not be able to train themselves for their job. So at the same time, we're also training we're educating the children on how to be a part of a sustainable community while their parents are getting jobs for the future. So it's circular to stay within the community and help the majority of Dominicans who don't have access to make sustainable solutions an option on their daily lives.
Thank you, girls. We have Karina and Inka raising their hand, and they each have 1 minute.
Okay. Gracias, Laura, Irene, Italia. So regarding the discounts for bringing, have you considered, first of all, the purchasing? Because every time I see the platos del día, I think most of my migraines come from there because it's so much and so many, and like you say, it's so cheap. So I've approached groups, let's say the food truck towns, that you have all these conglomerates and their groups, and their complaint is always the elevated cost. So we've tried to get them all together to buy in big, you know, in volume. So I don't know if you've considered thinking about that in for associations, consortiums, groups of some sort.
Well, absolutely. Sorry.
Yeah. Go ahead, Dalia.
And second point, the second point, I don't know if you've also considered the discounts for bringing your own containers. I see some incorporating that into the business model if you're trying to reduce the use of foam when cost is a problem. Okay.
Absolutely. Cost for us was a very big part of the whole idea, which is why we wanted to use raw materials in small communities and train those small communities to continue using these products. Because yes, they're more expensive to make, but they're mostly more expensive to make because you're using materials that are not local and you're importing and you're moving from one town to another. So if I have this town that makes a lot of caña, I'm gonna try to use their caña products, and there's gonna be a business that probably tried to work with that, but didn't have the resources to do it. So it's again, that circular economy, creating a system that works with what we have, the raw materials, reduce the carbon footprints, and provide something for the communities.
Yes, and regarding giving your own container, we also thought about that, but the thing is that these low-income people have very practical lives because they don't have a lot of luxury, like middle class. So we didn't want them to be tied to have to carry around their things. And in this first phase, we wanted to provide them just an alternative for the foam, that it's not more expensive. Later on, after this first cycle of education, we will try to incorporate the no use of disposable at all.
Thank you, Laura. Inka?
Thank you. I have a very quick question. What is innovation in the workshops?
Of course.
What makes people change their behavior?
Yes, so in the workshops, what we are trying to do is first trying to educate them so they can see the impact of their actions in the climate. Because right now, people, it's not real, at least in low-income communities, they are not really aware of how their actions impact. They think that because I'm only one person, I throw this can here, and that doesn't matter because I'm only one. They're not seeing that they are also being part of that problem. So the first step is for them to let them know. And the innovation here is, we know that these companies doing these containers already exist, and the workshops already exist, but what doesn't exist is the conjunction of that given to the community, so they have their own economy for them to be autonomous, and for them to be able to be part of the solution. Because normally, governments impose solutions to the people, and especially low-income communities are not given the opportunity to be part of that solution.
Thank you very much, Team One. Up next, we have Team Four, and I will let you know when to begin.
Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Can you hear me all right?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
And the timer is set for you.
Okay. Can you see my screen as well?
Yes.
Awesome. Ready when you are.
Okay, the timer is set for Team Four.
Good evening, everyone. Very excited to be here today presenting to you Núcleo, a circularity lab. So, as the judges probably know better than myself, pigmented PET has very low market value as it increases recycling process complexity and makes it hard for companies to meet their recycling targets and reduce their overall environmental impact. So our proposed solution is to create a triple impact company for products made from pigmented PET and non-PET plastics to help our clients meet their recycling targets and strengthen their environmental responsibility. So who are our clients? plastic industries in the country who are struggling to find local strategic partnerships and initiatives to manage low recyclability waste generated from the use of their products in order to strengthen their overall brand environmental responsibility. So Nuclu proposes a way to rethink plastic. As products reach the end of their life cycle and become waste, Nuclu comes in to collect and deliver the secondary raw material to our innovation workshop, where it's classified and processed into new products. These are the machines we'll be working with. So let's get down to business. We first collect the material, unwanted, low recyclability material, from companies and partners. Companies pay a fixed fee for recycled plastic tons. And we then give periodic reports with recycling indicators that help companies measure their progress towards those targets as the collected material is weighed before processing. Then we get to processing the secondary raw material into new products, which are then sold initially through partner vendors, but hopefully eventually through our very own Nuclu shop. So these are some of our potential partners. Hopefully there will be many more. It's just an open invitation. And of course, our product is stemmed in sustainability. So the triple impact concern for our company is on the economic side to create new job opportunities, improve corporate indicators, solidify circular economy models, and the environmental side, reduce the carbon footprint of our companies, increased use of secondary raw material that are designed for reuse, and addressing the extended responsibility of the producer of these companies that are already starting to address that and put it in the agenda. On the social side, we aim to provide equitable, livable, and improved recreational spaces, overall better health as materials don't end up in landfills, and accessibility to eco-friendly products. Also, we hope that as our initiative matures, it will be used as an innovation, creative, an open environment that invites for education, creativity, and innovation for company employees, overall consumers, all of us, basically, and hopefully students too that find in our hub a space to work and innovate with these products and create their own new products with creative as it gets. This is our team. We are two engineers, a civil engineer and engineer in sustainable development. And I work with companies strengthening their sustainability strategies. We produce 24,000 tons of waste, only 8% gets recycled. So let's change those numbers. Join Nuclu.
Thank you so much. And right away we have Jake and Javier with a question.
I'm tempted to let Javier go first because you know more about plastics. But just two things. One, it sounds great. I love the specificity of it. It sounds like it's such a specific problem. Is there other plastics that could be incorporated into this? Because besides PET plastics, colored PET plastics, it seems like there's a lot of other plastic material that just doesn't have a recycle value. And then the other question is, how are you sort of increasing the value of these products? Is it just because you're separating them and trying to find specific uses for them? Or is there a way to approach the actual companies that are producing them and change the formula of whatever the chemistry or the coloration pigments they're using so that it can be more easily recycled or more easily transformed into something more beneficial?
Thank you. So the beauty of the machines is that we can recycle many other types of plastic. You do have to sort them based on thickness and other specific properties, but you can include other types of plastics. As for your other question,
is there other changes in the process that could make these plastics more valuable? I mean, is there something you could talk to the company and say, remove XYZ pigment and all of a sudden it's more valuable? Is there a conversation that could be had that maybe some of these plastic producers are just not thinking along those lines? I don't know if it's like the energy drinks have a certain color or whatever.
Yeah, so the conversation is already happening and companies are already working to make some of those packaging more recyclable. But we do have specific products such as malts that need specific colors to maintain the quality of the product. So while we get there, and there's also a lot of like market barriers to changing the way your product looks. So this poses a solution while we get there to all those products that aren't can't change the way you know they look or the feel or the material. So it's the conversation is happening. We're hoping that every time more companies do make their packaging more recyclable and reduce packaging. But meanwhile, we hope this provides a solution.
Thank you, Jake. Javier?
I think this is a great presentation and a great idea. It definitely, you're taking something that has a relatively no commercial value right now, that are people are dumping away. Even the recyclers don't know what to do with it. So if by adding value through extrusion and transforming into another product, I'm pretty sure you can find a way of adding sufficient value to make it to make a big profit, considering the raw materials are basically at no cost. What type of products have you considered manufacturing with these materials, considering that's what's going to drive the demand for your production?
Hello, Javier. One of the examples we used was making filament for the 3D printers because there's no producer here at the Dominican Republic. So when it's all imported, the retail price for each meter of 3D filament is extremely expensive. And when it comes to the manufacturing process using recycled plastics, it's essentially the same. It's almost the same melting point. It's exactly the same mold and it's really the same injection. So we can make a product that is crucially needed here for innovation at our country at a way less cheaper price and a really, really low manufacturing price.
Yeah. Interesting fact, 3D printing is growing like 35% a year. The industry is still at a small stage, but at that growth rate, it should be, this type of project should be scalable to a larger size.
Thank you. We're hoping to scale it, yeah. And we actually found that just shredded plastic can be sold for like 8 to 10 times the value of the unshredded plastic. So even just shredding would already, you know, be managing a little bit of a problem.
Definitely. Johanna, you had a question, but then I saw you put your hand down. If you still want to ask.
I just wanted to precisely ask which products they were thinking of creating, and Javier asked that question.
But okay. Honestly, the sky's the limit. And we're hoping that innovative space will actually give room for creativity and new products as we go on, as the project develops.
Thank you.
One quick question. Why is no one doing this now? It doesn't seem that complicated. Like, why isn't there somebody doing this already?
I don't know.
What's the barrier to this business? Is it the buying of the equipment, or is it the logistics, or like it seems like if the value goes up just by shredding it, why wouldn't somebody have thought of this already?
Honestly, at least in the country, what I see is that there's no formal middleman to make upcycling real or to make upcycling viable.
Karina, you have a question, and again, you have like 1.5 minutes.
Yes, because precisely that, I was going to ask if you have a preliminary numbers or an idea of any sign-ins, you know, company sign-ins, if you've shopped it around from, I saw you put a photo of the AARD, so just that group, if you had any sign-in of numbers of companies' percentages, because it seems like an easy sell.
We are hoping it is an easy sell. We have been part of conversations with companies where, you know, they're reaching out to grassroots initiatives to finish
We were trying to get like the ratio of the whole product, the whole products they have available, like the ones that are easily recyclable to the ones that are harder to recycle. And it's actually higher than we thought initially. And we found that that is actually increasing even in markets like Europe and the United States where they have higher recyclability rates. The rate of pigmented plastic, for example, or like hard to recycle plastic is increasing. So we're hoping to target that in particular. And it seems like the problem is here as well from conversations with various companies. They are looking for grassroots initiative to finish tackling those numbers to be able to reach those pretty high goals. Because here we have say like Coca-Cola with their 2030 zero waste objective. We have Cervecería Nacional that wants to recycle 100% of the products that they put in the market. So we have.
Thank you, Natalie, and thank you, judges. We are time's up for team four. Up next, we have team two, and we're going to give the judges a few minutes to put in their judging criteria.
Natalie, can you stop sharing, please? Thank you.
And while we wait, I just want to read Robin, one of our facilitators' quote that he wrote in the chat box that I find really, really great. And he says, sometimes the simplest idea is overlooked because of the same reason that people think someone is already doing it. And then he says, it makes the idea even more interesting to explore.
Just one second. So share. No, share this. Do you all see my full screen?
Yes, you should change display settings so that we can see the full presentation and not the viewer presentation part.
How do I do that?
Up top.
Uh-huh.
There, it says display setting right next to that. There.
Swap view and slideshow.
Yeah.
Like this?
Yes.
Okay, great.
And timer is set. You can begin.
Okay, hello everybody, thank you for your time. We are team two, known as Lo Uso, and we're bringing you today Trash Flow 2.0. So like many of us who are Dominican and other countries, this is the current situation. Basically, there's no proper waste disposal for any socioeconomic sector, but specifically for low income, it's really prominent problem, which gives birth to the top right images, which are the buzos themselves that end up digging for trash in landfills. Even though we know that the low-income socioeconomic strata is not specifically the Jubelkis, which is our persona to represent the person, Jubelkis is the one that we decided to focus because they tend to range from 35 to 45, and they live in barrios, which are cities where there is no proper city planning, so streets are really, really narrow and uphill. There is a hyper overpopulation. They tend not to trust so much local outsiders, but more local leaders. And they all want less trash, more income, better health, and better services. So concretely defining the problem, we decided that the family's household decision makers in the barrios, mostly females like Jubelki, need to understand a clear connection between proper waste management and positive rewards or negative impact, because otherwise, they won't put on the effort in classifying their trash, and the success of future waste management projects and investments are is surely going to be compromised. So this is where we bring you Trashflow 2.0, a new waste management system via nodes. So the first step in how it works is that you have your household, which produces your waste, and you have two options. You either take the trash yourself to the nodes that I will explain further in the next slide, or you have door-to-door pickups by whom used to be previously the Buzos. And in this transaction, in either of the two situations, you get an exchange of your waste for a fee. On the next step of the core system, you have the collection nodes, which tend to be very populated and frequent centers like churches, school, colmados, with waste control method in order so that when they receive the wastes, they can properly weigh and pay the whoever brings the waste to the place. Once classified in the collection nodes, it's since they are located in easily accessible streets or places because they already buy from companies that deliver in trucks, it's way more easier for recycling and upcycling companies to establish those points as picking up points for the waste that they have already classified and established. Obviously, it's a large scale program, so we have to define some initial steps. The first is designing a training program for the collection nodes and the community leaders to diffuse among the community to the rest of the community. Also, since this is basing on the existing economy of the Buzos that we previously mentioned, we have to determine a clear economic flow from what the current Buzos customers are paying in order to structure economic benefit system. We have to engage the colmados, churches, and schools that we mentioned in the implementation and promote via the community leaders the project phase of this system and the awareness of local availability for training. How do we know it's working?
Thank you, Diego. Time's up, but I see Johanan has a question, so go ahead.
Yes, loving the community aspect of the project. More so because we often don't work as much as we should with church leaders and community leaders down in the in some communities.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Javier.
Yeah, I have a recommendation in the economic income part about giving credits for materials. There might be barriers from tax point of view. So I might recommend maybe getting affiliate companies to give coupons, for example, materials for gas at a gas station or coupons for food. So you give plastics or cans for food. And it might make it easier to have that transaction happen and not have to have a large accounting book of transactions.
Yeah, okay,
yes,
that makes sense.
That's something that we have an idea, for example, in Colmado that are like local grocery stores, they can have credit for basic products, family basic products. It is a such a great idea, so they can have access to food and with the motivation to give them Colmados the product that they already classified.
Thank you, Jake.
Yeah, I love the idea. I like the whole concept. It seems very similar to something that was done in Curitiba in Brazil, where the, in the favelas, it's very difficult to get trash trucks into these, you know, very small street neighborhoods. And so they were paying collectors to bring the material down, and or the families to pay, bring the materials down to a more centralized location. But the question for me is, that was done by a municipality. So that was how it was paid for, by the city government. How does your company get paid? Like, where do you guys come in? Or is this, are you sort of facilitators that then, you know, the government pays you instead of paying the collection company? Like, how, where does your business model come from? And then how does it scale up?
Sure thing. So first of all, one clarification, maybe I spoke too quickly. This is not a company proposal. It's a change of system and flow of how the process actually works. It could be very well implemented by private sector or public sector. In regards to your specific question, we determined that even though we currently have an already existing economy, that you could say there's an established rate for the recycling, let's say a recycled pound of plastics. That tends to be very general, but there's already a rate in the market. So what we're trying to do is to channelize and properly structure the flow of everything in order so that we get one, the waste classified from the households, because the whole purpose of this project and changing mindset is to be able to lay the ground for further projects, recycling projects, to be able be easier to implement. One of the hurdles that all of the recycling projects face, even in the conception stage, is that it's really hard for them to do the financial viability or even the whole viability, due to the fact that waste tend to come really mixed up from the origin. So once, if you solve that issue, you already are laying the ground to make it easier for other projects to flourish. So while I do agree that we could structure it a little bit more in terms of the business model, to call it like this, it would either be to whoever is interested, be it public or private.
Thank you, Diego. Ginny, you are raising your hand. Go ahead.
Yes. Hello, Diego. You know, the economic challenges of this kind of program is huge. But using Javier's suggestion of making, like, promoting a trueque, like an exchange, I bring my, for, with churches, personally, we've worked with churches before. You bring this and the church can have some coupons or facility. And what my suggestion would be, which is something that we have been exploring for a long time. You know, the government pays off a lot of social benefits to poor communities for doing nothing. Just here, have money, you know? And if this kind of program could be lobbied into these social programs sponsored by the government and say, listen, environmental programs is a huge challenge for the country. Maybe we can generate an alliance that communities and families receive this solidaridad, is that they call it here, but you have to do something in exchange. And that would be, you get your card and you get your money, but you collaborate back to the country by bringing your recyclables or something like that. And I'm sure this is something, a good, I understand it's a good momentum now to create this kind of alliance with these social programs of the government.
Thank you, Jeannie. For sure, we did touch on a lot of the points that you mentioned.
Thank you so much, Team 2. And last but not least, we have Team 9. Oh, sorry, Karina just raised her hand. And I'll give you 30 seconds. Go ahead.
I just wanted to mention that in the chat, somebody said something interesting, and I think it's done in another country where you get metro tickets, like that sort of incentive, but it's additional, and everybody needs transportation. So one of the participants actually put it up there.
Yeah, that's interesting, because one of the things we determined that is that one of the problems with, let's say, broad range projects is that it's really hard to evaluate the feasibility because they're so broad by definition. But one of the things why we determine it, I didn't have time to explain it, but it's right here in the slide, is that if you start implementing this project and people, obviously, it's a curve. You're not going to have no recycling or no classification to 100%. But during this curve, you tend to have the possibility to measure, whether it be pounds of whatever recycled or classified or whatever it is, you get data, you get metrics. Based on these metrics, we can do something similar to what other group mentioned, that is gamification of this. One of the characteristics of low-income communities is that they tend to be, they know each other. Like, I know my neighbor from three blocks away. So it's way easier to build a sense of community and belonging. And if you have that, you can therefore build on that and create games. Like, not to put a bad example, like the reverse of a Hunger Games, joyful games in which the barriers from
all. Thank you.
Sorry
again. Time's up for team two. Up next, we have team nine, and I'll give you guys a few seconds to put in your judging before I set.
Hello everyone, good night. This is Team 9 and we're going to present to you door-to-door collection
system. Team 9, I will let you know when we are ready to begin. Just give them a minute or two and I'll let you know.
Very well.
Okay, Team 9, the timer is set for you.
Okay, thank you. Good night, everyone. Thank you for waiting for us. This is Team 9, and we're going to present to you door-to-door collection system. Julesi is a resident of Villaflor, a vulnerable community in Salcedo, located far from the main roads. Her community has grown rapidly and irregularly and has restricted vehicle access. Most communities like Julesi's don't have frequent waste collection services, if at all, because local governments have not found innovative and cost-effective ways to offer this service. So Julesi and her family throws her trash wherever they see fit, in green areas, empty lots, sideways, waterways. The residents of Villaflor don't understand the negative impact that improper waste is having on their quality of life. Because vulnerable communities like this one are not organized and have low education levels, it is difficult and time consuming for them to demand solutions from their local government. But they need their trash taken care of now.
This is why we propose the implementation of door-to-door collection, a program where residents of vulnerable, hard-to-access communities get involved, get educated, and get rewarded. In the first phase, we solve the immediate need of this community by solving the problem of waste disposal, developing a fleet of tricycles that collect solid waste from homes on specific days and times of the week, taking the waste to a common collection point where the municipality can then remove it. For the second phase, we're proposing that residents are educated regarding responsible consumption, the impact of waste on their health and the environment, and on recyclable material business opportunities. designated residents from the community will then have the opportunity to manage the common collection point as a sorting center. This social program model combines guidelines from other successful waste management programs like zero waste and single stream collection, adapting to our users' reality. It not only addresses the residents' needs, but it also has the potential to impact the community socially, economically, and of course, the environment, improving their overall quality of life. Our program can be adopted, both by public and private sectors or entities. And it is, by both public and private alliances. Join us in empowering communities to take control of their waste and live a more sustainable life. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Team 9. Do any of the judges have questions or comments? Okay, first we have Karina and then we have Jeannie.
Hey guys. I love the bicicleteros. You mentioned education as one of the pillars. Have you given any thought on whose hands is that education? Yeah, get involved, get educated. So educating the residents regarding all of this business opportunities and consumption and everything. Have you thought about who fits into that model? Who will take over that education component, which seems pivotal.
Yeah, so the way we get involved in this is as a consulting team since we don't have defined which entity, private or public, is going to take care of this program. We're sort of proposing that we will be the consulting team that would guide this education. So it can either be that we request and prepare the facilitators or that an entity like the Ministry of Education gets involved and bring in their own specialists, and we do a cooperation and an education based on cooperation.
Okay. Thank you. Jenny?
We've thought.
Hello, Marion. Hola. Who pays for the collectors? Their tricycle? There's a health insurance. How is that structured?
Thanks for the question. It is structured as a cooperative. Both the collectors and the collection node, to call it some way, is based on a cooperative. So they are part of the main chain, based on the income that makes the nodes selling the waste to the private company that are going to upcycle or recycle the materials. They are paid based on the weight of the actual waste.
But you know, there are costs.
I was going to add to that what we are considering on the first phase is that the entities involved in implementing the program in whichever community is chosen first, we'll have to take into consideration that these individuals' salary for the first months for the implementation of phase one. And then once we transfer over to phase two, where the community starts generating income, then that income is going to be split between the community managers of the sorting center and these collectors.
You know, let me tell you, maybe you know about the five foundations by the Rio Sama, Escoba, Funza Sursa, Fucosigua 27. They do this kind of work, and they are sustainably because they are paid by the municipality. It is not enough, and it will not be enough to live from what they sell. If you want to establish a cooperative and that they are that they give this service in a good way, you understand? So I think you have to maybe consider making an alliance with the municipality, so that the municipality, if you are a sale, for example, approach the mayor and say that this program is basically sponsored by them, because it will be cost, you know, the cost will not be enough from the recyclables, you know?
Definitely. And what we're thinking, obviously it would be ideal to have the municipality come in and be a part of this. But the fact that this is not going to be a full-time job for collectors in our tricycle program means that this can be considered an additional income for them. So that's something else that we're considering. But definitely having subsidy would be ideal.
You know, Thank you so much. You know, many municipalities, they pay many people who are doing part-time. So that maybe there is an arrangement there that these part-time employees can have this kind of duties, you know?
Excellent, yeah, we'll consider that.
Thank you, Ginny, thank you, Marion. And before we finish with team nine, Jake has 1 minute.
Just saying, similar to what Ginny was saying, is I think you're calling it a subsidy, but I mean, really what you're receiving payment for a service. So you're, instead of a waste collection service that's just taking the waste from a neighborhood to the dump, you're saying there's a different process involved in the middle that we're going to help facilitate and we should be paid for service. So it seems like you should, you know, market it similar to the other group with the nodes, that it's not just a charity. This is really like a service you're offering, you know, and you called it a consultancy, but I think it's a similar idea.
Noted. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Team 9 and all the judges. I really don't want to be you right now. I honestly can't think of which one I like best. So good luck with that. I think you need more luck than all the teams that we're presenting now. If you're watching the live, please don't go anywhere. We're going to give the judges a few minutes to go over their judging criteria and then just decide who is the winner of tonight's event. And we will be back on the live in a few moments. So thank you so much for being with us and good luck to the judges with their job.
Thank you.
¿Podemos mover a los jueces a su sala, por favor?
Yes.
No puedo ahora.
Un segundo, ahora les mandamos un link alterno.
Sorry, this is live and technology sometimes works against us, but we are moving the judges to the breakout room now.
Ginny, Karina, and you already have been assigned, so if you can go to that VIP room.
Should I wait for a link to go to the other room?
You should have a pop-up that says join a breakout room.
No, I don't see it.
It's not coming up. We know the breakout room, but it's not coming up.
Where you guys have the four little dots on the next to chair screen, maybe?
No,
I don't see you either.
No worries, we'll find a way. And if not, we're gonna send a link to move. Let's have a few more minutes to see if we can do it over here. And if not, we just move to another Zoom meeting.
Maybe it's easier just to move to another Zoom.
So judges, Kristi is going to send you a link for a different meeting so that you can go there because we're having trouble with the breakout rooms.
Okay.
So just beware.
Hey, talents, while we're waiting, I'm looking on the main Miro board and I only see three testimonials. Can you take a few minutes while we're waiting now for the judges to deliberate? Just go there to the main Miro board and add a testimonial about your experience this weekend. You'll also see it on the right-hand side.
While we're waiting, you should definitely do that. While we're waiting, I have some sustainable development goal related trivia for you. So get your hands ready on the hand raising thing. I don't have any prizes yet, but I will figure something out. So question number one, who can name all of the sustainable development goals without Googling it? Raise your hand. Who wants to try naming all of them without looking it up?
Jake is already raising his hand.
Jake is a judge. Jake does not count because Jake is supposed to be going to judge somewhere. I want a participant to do this, although thank you, Jake. I appreciate it.
I am lowering your hand then.
I was not offering. That was from the last one.
Maybe a pair or a group of you could come together to do it.
Or if you want to name as many as you can, let's see if we can name them collectively.
Good idea.
All right, Diego, I can do what I can on you. Diego, go for it. How many can you name?
Access to clean water, reduce poverty, or eradicate poverty, the ones we're working on. So sustainable cities and communities, responsible consumption and production.
Excellent.
Better health service, I think, is one of them.
There is good health, I think. Good health and well-being is one of them. Yeah.
I named five. I'm passing the passing the bar to somebody else.
All right, call. Yeah. Who can help?
Affordable energy.
Yes.
Climate action.
Yes.
Life in ecosistemas terrestres.
life on land.
Yes, and life on water.
Awesome.
And SDG 17 is with alliances. I don't know the name.
Partnerships and, for the goals.
SDG number 9 is, or 12 is reduction of inequalities.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
That was number 9, I think.
Ah, okay. Okay, cool. Then
that's all. You guys are getting closer. Excellent.
How many have we said so far?
I lost count, but you've said, I would say, 2/3 of them. Sayuris. You're muted.
I'm sorry. Poverty, hunger, health, education.
Education, thank you.
Climate change, gender equality.
Good.
Life in land, life in ocean, sustainable cities, partnerships. What else? Wait. Responsible consumption.
Yes.
Wait a minute.
Economical growth.
Yes, decent work and economic growth.
Yeah.
There's only one more y'all are missing.
Gender.
You said gender, and I was waiting for somebody to say gender, so thank you. You are missing, there is only one you are missing.
Only one? Wait a minute. What am I forgetting? Energy.
No, energy has been said.
Okay.
Does anybody know the last one?
Reduced partnerships. 17.
No, we said climate change. We said partnerships.
Reduced inequalities, right?
No, we said that. It is peace, justice, and strong institutions.
Peace.
Peace. It's nice. All right. Does anybody know
interrupt you for one minute before we continue with the trivia? I just want to make sure that that everybody remembers that they have to submit their ideas through the Miro link by tonight. So please don't forget to do that. Also, if you go the Miro, you can download them so that you can keep everything you've been working on. That's very important for you to do. Make sure that you have your team's contact so that you can continue pursuing this after tonight. I don't know if you created your WhatsApp group. I do know that in the main Miro board, there's like a list of phone numbers. So if you wanna have like a Dominican Republic Unleashed Hack WhatsApp group, someone should start that now before you lose the contacts that are there. So if you haven't done that, I suggest you do that now while we're waiting and while we do the trivias. And also, it is very important for you to think about what is going to happen to your ideas after tonight. So I know you know that the three teams that win are going to get a prize so that you can continue furthering this. And maybe some of the judges might offer working with you after this on as well, but you are free to look into different ways to expand your ideas and the things you've come up with. So it's very important that as a team, you think about what comes next. And I'll leave you with that. Hillary, back to the trivia.
Yes, if you guys want to go off and talk about your, you know, next steps, please don't do the trivia at the expense of that. But if you need a little bit of a break, then here we are. Your next question is, there was a set of goals that preceded the Sustainable Development Goals. What were they called?
The MDGs.
not leaving everyone behind.
So you're both right. The Millennium Development Goals were disestablished to not leave anybody behind. Excellent. How many Millennium Development Goals were there?
Millennium?
Eight. The Millennium Development Goals were, they were supposed to eradicate by 2015, eradicate extreme poverty and hunger, achieve universal primary education, promote gender equality, reduce child mortality, improve maternal health, combat HIV/AIDS, malaria, and other diseases, ensure environmental sustainability, and develop a global partnership for development. Spoiler alert, we did not achieve all of those, which is why we have these sustainable development goals, which are more specific. Okay, here's your next question. One of the very first precursors to the sustainable development goals was a meeting that was held in Stockholm, Sweden, for the United Nations Conference on the Human Environment to consider the rights of the family to a healthy and productive environment. That meeting took place in what year?
1972-ish?
Yes, 1972.
Wow. Me, Natalie.
Wow. Amazing. Yes, that was 1970. I did not know that until I just saw it on the Wikipedia a few minutes ago. So congratulations.
I've had to pitch that one sometimes.
I think it's good to know this sort of information. Let's see what other trivia we have. Ban Ki-moon famously said about the sustainable goals that we don't have a plan B because why?
There's no other planet.
There is no planet B. Yeah. Excellent. And here is a fun fact about Ban Ki-moon. I used to teach in Korea, and when Ban Ki-moon became the Secretary General of the United Nations, I saw a massive upsurge in students who wanted to become diplomats as their job because they had a famous diplomat to look up to. All right, let's see. What is another question that we can ask about these? Well, here's a fun fact. Biodiversity is not actually included in here. It is somewhat included in that there's some about the environment, but there is not an explicit goal about biodiversity. All right, I'm gonna ask some questions about specific goals. Let's see. Let's talk about, good health and well-being. Can anybody name any of the targets for good health and well-being? You can probably guess some of these.
Water, like quality or something.
That I think is underwater, actually. That's I'm not trying to be snarky. I believe that is, there is reduced illness and deaths from hazardous chemicals and pollution. So we could say that roughly has to do with water. What other kinds of deaths and health problems do we want to fight?
Reduce the children's deaths, like
yes.
Birth deaths.
Ending all preventable deaths under 5 years of age. Excellent. Can somebody give me another one? All right, I will give you one. Road injuries. We want to reduce road injuries. That is another target. Achieving universal health coverage. Ensuring reduction of mortality from non-communicable diseases and promotion of mental health. Development and universal access to affordable vaccines and medicines. And supporting the health workforce. All right, I think I am actually out of trivia questions for the sustainable development goals. Eileen, did you learn anything fun about the sustainable development goals when you were in Shenzhen that you want to ask us as a question?
Way to put me on the spot, Hillary.
I know, I'm very sorry, I'm quite tired.
Maybe we should do some Unleashed trivia.
Oh, that would be fun. Yeah, let's do Unleashed trivia.
Okay, do we have any facts?
I wanted to ask a question.
Sure. Oh, yeah. And we can also do Q&A about Unleash if y'all have questions.
Yeah. It's regarding the adjective, the millennia adjective, and the one regarding the health.
Yeah.
Basically, that they are most focused in physical health, but there's nothing relating to psychological health because
there is.
There is.
Yeah, there is, but it's only one, and it has to share its time with non-communicable diseases.
Okay.
So I think that's a really good point because mental health is often not considered in the same, to be prioritized in the same way as physical health. We can ask some Unleash trivia questions. If you have questions about Unleash itself, please feel free to raise your hand and ask those as well. But I do have at least one trivia question for you. What beer company is a major space, is a major sponsor of Unleash? I should say beverage company, but what beverage, primarily beer company, is a major Unleash sponsor?
Deloitte? It would be Anheuser-Busch?
It is not Anheuser-Busch.
Deloitte?
Deloitte is not a beer company to my knowledge.
Miller? It is an Unleash sponsor though.
It is an Unleash sponsor. They just don't sponsor, they just don't make beer yet. I mean, who knows? They might diversify.
Miller, is it Miller?
It's not Miller.
You should give us a letter.
I can give you a region.
It's Corona? Is it Corona?
It's not Corona. It's a company that comes from Scandinavia.
Carlsberg.
It is Carlsberg. That is right. The Carlsberg beers flow freely at Unleashed events because the chairman of the board of Carlsberg is a huge supporter of the Sustainable Development Goals. He played an integral role in getting Unleash off the ground.
I have seen no free-flowing Carlsberg so far.
It's because of the pandemic.
Okay.
Why am I blanking on his name? Fleming Bessenbacher, he's amazing. He is the chairman of the Carlsberg Foundation and the Carlsberg Group. And he was the one who had the original vision. What is the name of the kind of school where Unleash was held the first year? Karim talked about this morning.
Folk school.
A folk school. Excellent. Who is the president? Who is the former? That's not, that question didn't come out right. Never mind. I was going to ask a trivia question about Singapore, and I couldn't formulate it properly. How many years has Unleash been in existence?
Three.
Who is raising
your
hand? Specifically? Matthew Ureño, because you are raising your hand.
Oh.
It's 3 years.
It is 3 years. So 2017, 2018, 2019, we're in our fourth year. Absolutely. What actor gave the keynote at the Singapore Unleash? He famously played Idi Amin.
He played what?
He played Idi Amin, the king of the former president of Uganda. He's an American actor. Maybe he is not actually famous outside of America. We have a question from Marion. On the Google form, you're asked for user description. I think you can be as specific as you would like to be. I would recommend being at least as specific as you stated in your problem. You don't have to give the full persona, but I would at least be as specific as you stated in your problem.
Thank you.
The answer to the trivia.
Forrest
Whitaker. That's right. Forrest Whitaker gave a speech to us.
He's very involved in these sort of communities as well, right?
I think he is indeed.
Yeah.
And he is, I believe, a famous vegan. so yeah, Forrest Whitaker.
I remember he was speaking at a Swedish event also. Right.
Yeah, that is true. I'm trying to think because, let's see.
Does anyone have questions for us about Unleash? In years past or
years future? We can't answer those really, but we can try to.
I do have a question regarding on the track of the Unleash past events. Is there any statistics on the percentage of ideas that get further developed into actual projects in the real world?
That is a great question. And the answer is that they're studying that right now. So they were actually partnering with, I want to say, University of Michigan. To do a fuller study on it. But I think that they've had to adjust the parameters somewhat because they're trying to look at both Unleash and Unleash Plus. So the shorter answer is they're looking at it, and that's a big part of how they're trying to continually iterate and improve. But I don't think they have the answers yet.
So maybe question, what is plus and normal?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, yeah.
Hillary, maybe you could explain the two different tracks.
Yes, that's a good idea. So Unleash was originally just the standalone event for, and it was similar to this, but it was 1,000 people. brought together for many more days, but following the same process that you're following. So that happened in 2017 in Denmark, 2018 in Singapore, and 2019 in Shenzhen. In Shenzhen, they added two more tracks. One was called Unleash Plus. And Unleash Plus is more of an accelerator. It is for alumni who are working on ideas that actually have some traction and need to take the next step. So for example, companies that have already produced a prototype and are working on trying to break into new markets. I think the only example that I'm thinking of right now is the fish jerky company, but I've seen, so for example, one of my teammates from my team had a separate NGO that was helping young people in England access university education more effectively. And so his team was called Project Access, and they went to Unleash Plus. So Unleash Plus is a similar duration, but the process is somewhat different because it's more advanced. And there was also a third track called Unleash Storytellers. And Unleash Storytellers brought in people who were talented communicators, whether they were filmmakers or musicians or writers, to document Unleash as it was happening, I believe, and also to create communications related to the SDGs. I don't remember as much about Storytellers, Eileen. Does that sound right?
Yeah, that's right. They did some really cool short videos and stuff that you can find on YouTube and I think also on the Unleash website about last year's program.
So yeah.
Sorry, Hillary, again for interrupting.
No, don't be sorry.
Porfirio is raising his hand, and I, listening to you talk, I wanted to ask Eileen if she could talk about Unleash Plus, because I heard you were a facilitator, and maybe some of the talents here might be interested in pursuing that in the future.
Okay. Sorry, did you say there was a hand raised? Should we answer that question?
Yes, let's raise that. Let's answer that.
Yeah, let's
answer
first, and then,
Hi, hi, guys. Well, I have two questions. One of them was exactly what you just said about what about Unleash Plus. So, and if we as talent or alumni after this, are we able to go for it and apply? And second, what happened next with us as alumni and talents? Are we still connected? Are we still considered for further opportunities? How can we get in touch in the future?
Do we have any of the organizing team in here?
Yes. Well, as you know, this is the first Unleash Hack in the first weekend that we have these hacks doing online and specific to a country. So Unleash still is exploring how this option and how this hacking works and what can be expanded. As far as we know, you're going to be part of the Unleash platform, to which you were all invited already, the community platform. So it looks like a Facebook, and all the partners, ecosystem partners of Unleash are there, and they will be posting events and opportunities there, and you will have access to those. So those will be available only to the Unleash community, and you're part of it. As far as Unleash Plus, I guess that's something that is still being explored, also because it's a very new program. This is the second time we do Unleash Plus. So it's kind of in the making. But you all have the contact information of the facilitators and the other teams, and we ask you to follow the other hacks and just stay tuned to Unleash and the opportunities that will rise from that.
Regarding this topic, I wanted to mention that it is really I've been in Singapore on 2018, and this is the first hack that I'm doing online, and I think it's really good that there is a lot of people from the country. So that is because in Singapore, in person, we have a mix of nationalities, and it's also really good. But when you want to contextualize the problem and like be more specific, I think this is a really good thing to have a lot of people from the same place or that at least knows the country. So like, or the context or something related to what you are doing. So that was really, really good. Just as a feedback. I write it down in the notes there in the experience thing, but I think I wanted to mention it now in this media.
Yes, thank you. And as far as we know, these hacks were supposed to be in person. So it's just that because of COVID that we had to make them online, but they were supposed to be organized by former alumni and talents and people related to Unleash at the local level, just to make them more relatable and more applicable and more immediately actionable.
Yeah, that's amazing, because also another thing, like now that you are asking about the next steps and all of that, my team, we found very, very difficult to like find the time frame and everything. We were five people from all over the world, and we had different time frames, all of us, and it was really difficult to continue with the idea. And the idea was really good, so that's a shame. So this is something that I think is really positive of this. It's like another way of doing it that can also bring some good things, I think.
Yes, definitely.
Thank you, Sigrid. Very good feedback.
And just to remind you, in the next few days, Unleash will contact you directly, the secretariat, and to ask for your feedback. So all these ideas and many others, please do share.
I also saw in the chat people talking about continuing to collaborate together. And I think that's a great idea, because something that you guys do have going for you is that a lot of you happen to live somewhat nearby or in some of the same time zones. And obviously, for those of you who don't, hopefully you can be brought into. But I think that continuing to work on these, even if this idea doesn't take off, the fact that you now know that there are these other people who are interested in the same topic is really powerful. So I hope that you continue to collaborate. Does anybody have any other questions while we are waiting? What was your favorite part of the weekend? Was it the costume thing this morning? Because that was pretty great.
Passing the gate.
Passing the gate is always exhilarating.
Honestly, I think that the best part of this experience is right now I don't feel alone. I don't know if that's something that I share with you guys, but sometimes you are in a circle of persons in your work or even your family, and you think, oh my God, but it is possible that I will have the opportunity to know people who have the same thoughts that I have. And I think that's the great experience. And yes, I'm so motivated to find people who have the feeling that I had before this hack, and to invite them that, yes, we have so many companies and programs that are working so hard, and they only need more support. And sometimes even because they don't have access to the information, maybe they are not part of this type of situation. Because in fact, I am part of this because I teach environmental science, and one of the mother of one of my students, she sent me the invitation. I have no idea of this. And I don't know, I contacted Karina, I don't know who was, I wrote them through the chat of Instagram, because I was so disappointed, because I know about this. I knew about this the last day to sign up to this program. And thanks God, I was accepted. So it was like a funny story. And I'm here, like, I don't know, because I'm so lucky.
I'm so glad to hear that. It is wonderful to be able to find a community. I think that's one of the best parts about Unleash. So I'm so glad to hear that. How are we doing on judges, guys, on organizing team?
They're having a hard time because they were all so great. Like, seriously.
Aww. I do have a question. How can I download my board in Miro? Have the option or
end it. Yeah, if you go to, so you have your Miro, if you see to the top left, there's like como una cinta that says Myro, da-da-da, and there's like a row pointing up in a box. Como una cajita con una flecha hacia arriba.
El lado izquierdo, una flechita, select.
Y dice export this board. Y le das clic y te dice guárdalo como imagen, PDF, template, spreadsheet, embed.
If you see my screen, it should be this.
Okay, yes. Let me see. Oh, no, I don't have that arrow.
I don't have it either.
That's the main thing.
Maybe it's a permissions issue. That.
Sorry, I think it's just people that hold the document. So the guest, we cannot download it. That's what I'm also having trouble on it.
I was like, oh my God, I'm lost.
Yeah.
If you try, did any of you create a user for Myro?
I did.
Yes. I did, and I don't have it either.
Yeah.
I think it's our role, maybe.
But I think it's because of the role, but I did something that worked for me. So maybe it worked for you too. And it's creating the frames. So if you go on the left corner down, you can see the frames that are already created. Huh? And so I created it more on the parts that I wanted to export. And then I exported one by one as images. So that's what worked for me, but I don't know if there is another way to just explore the whole thing.
I'm glad you say that you showed Team 7's organized chaos right there.
I honestly picked the first.
Oh my God, no one was paying attention to the board.
Maybe someone who has the ability to download the boards can just download each one and then send it to the teams or one member of the team.
Yeah. I'm going to download them all.
Yeah, we will send it.
Thank you. Also the main one with all the contacts, information and all of that. We received that one too?
Yes.
Thank you, Karina.
Anyone who's like good with design and all that, which format do you think it would be best? Because PDF would be like in a small size, no?
I think PDF is gonna have the highest resolution. I mean, it's that, well, actually no. Can you export as a PNG?
As an image, yes.
Yeah, so PNG will have you'll be able to open a PNG in any like image program and that will have the highest, I think, resolution when you zoom in.
One question also, like if you, will these be deleted or not?
Probably they will be eventually. We'll ask the secretary to leave them there until Wednesday, but eventually they will disappear.
Okay, no, because you can just star them and it ends up in your profile, but if you delete them, then no.
Yeah, I was doing the starring too. Yeah, I would do it as a PNG or a PDF. I think either of those should be okay.
We can try with one team the two ways, and then we can figure it out which one works better.
Yeah. Maybe.
It's funny whoever said the best part was lunch, because when we were in China, that was a notorious problem for a lot of... I've heard that my track was better than a lot, but we had the same food literally every day. And the way everybody's site worked, a lot of us like couldn't go to get other food. So we were like, my groups that I facilitated with, they were in a botanical garden. We took a bus to get there every day. We couldn't go anywhere. And so we were trapped and we ate the same cafeteria food every day for like 9 days. And by the end of it, I think everybody was ready to mutiny. They were bringing snacks from, the convenience store and that sort of thing. So I don't know, Riley, was it bad for you?
We had the same experience where we had one restaurant where we could go to eat lunch included in the program, but there were other options if you wanted something different, but you had to pay out of your own pocket. So you had to make the choice if you wanted to take what was given, which was the same thing every day for lunch and dinner, actually, or make your choice, but pay from your own pocket for it. So some people were disappointed by that. But I tried a lot of Chinese food that I had never had before. Mm. So I kind of liked being able to go to that restaurant and trying the different things. It wasn't like a menu. They gave you a buffet. Yeah. So you could just go through the buffet and like look at, oh, what is that? I don't know. I'll try it. I tried a lot of different things.
Yeah, I didn't mind it that much.
I think it varied based on what site you were at. Ours was okay compared to some of the other ones. I think it was more just that we couldn't go anywhere because we were literally in the middle of the garden.
Sorry to interrupt. The Miro thing, if I downloaded it as image or PDF, it actually looks like cutouts of pages. So, and that's why. So it doesn't work as an infinite whiteboard. But let me ask the secretariat, they should have a solution for this.
Yeah, I think it's framed, Karina. At least ours is framed, so it should come in like different pages. Even though it's not an infinite thing, but you will have like different pages that show the whole thing.
Would that be okay? Because it literally looks like a cutout and like pieces are cut in the middle and you cannot see the whole thing.
Yeah, that's why I think each team has to frame their things together. So like they will export the same, like the things that they want together in one page.
Can you screen share and show us what you mean by that?
I am having some difficulties by.
Oh, I understand. Don't worry about it.
Let me see if I can do it. Wait, let's do this together.
Yeah, if you share the screen, I can help you.
Okay, so I'm gonna go back. Let me go to a team. Okay, team 7, and then.
Yeah. So open the frame part that is below, and then you just do another one. So like all of that is framed. Like what you did is frame, and now you put a new frame, and now you have to frame the part you want to export.
Right.
And then you can copy that to a new board. I should also note that I don't know about the copying and pasting, but
no,
I think
this is gonna be like a PDF or something, and it's gonna be an image. So we cannot export the editable version. That's not possible.
So I can move the frame. You can.
Oops. You can have up to 3 free boards on Miro. So you might be able to just copy and paste it into your free board.
Yeah, if you have a membership and you open an another one, then you can copy your editable version. But exporting it, it's just the option is just image.
Yeah, I think that it might be good to set up a free membership if you're interested in that.
You can move the frame around, so you can create the frame and do different frames of the things you want to save.
Exactly, and you can also you can edit the frame.
I did this frame just for this, and then I can continue doing.
Do you hear me?
Yes.
So I just created a new free one. I deleted the mind map that appears, and then I pasted everything, and it pasted perfectly.
Yeah, the only limitation I think is that it's you can only have 3. But yes, that might be a good solution for some of you.
Loggering our page 7.
I did the frames for you, sorry.
I'm kidding, no, thank you, it's really necessary. Yeah.
We'll check with the secretariat to see if there is something else we can do.
Thank you all so much for your patience. We're working on getting the answers very soon of the judges, but it's a compliment to you all that it's taking so long because it's so hard to choose.
Yeah.
Guys, I was just able to explore my board, my Team 2 board, but I just realized that even if you have a free account, it doesn't allow you to export it in if you're exporting as an image as a high resolution, it limits the resolution. So I think we should get it from Unleash, guys.
Yeah, and also if it's too big, even in a frame, it doesn't show the whole thing. Or at least as far as
Yeah, I just did a test trying to export like a really big area, and obviously, everything's blurry, but it will take like forever exporting every little detail.
Yeah.
Diego, I don't know why I have a sense that I have met you before.
Probably. I know a couple of people that I've seen here.
Okay.
But
I have that same feeling. I feel like I know you from somewhere, but I cannot remember.
Who's talking?
Laura.
That you don't have the
yeah
Laura, your face looks really familiar,
right? I don't know from where, but I feel like I know you. Or did you study it in tech
for 1 year, 2008 to 2009?
Yeah. Oh hell no.
I started 2009 and finished 2013.
No. Did you do AFS exchange?
No.
I don't know. From life. We know each other from life.
Probably. For drinking at shots.
Maybe. That's a good meeting place for a lot of people.
That is very possible.
Maybe people just have that face.
I'm pretty sure I don't have that face.
You didn't have that face?
No, my face is really particular. I tend to be the Indian Dominican guy.
But by the way, I have the same film, like I've seen you before. I don't know from where. I could swear I just started in intake, but that was way too back in time.
Because I think I know you too. But I think from intake, I know you.
Sure, actually.
You're an industrial designer?
Yeah, sí, profe.
Yeah. She's
back yeah.
Yeah, she delivered the thesis with me.
Wait, are you talking to me, Nicole?
No, to me. I was Nicole's teacher at university. And I think I was also Patricia's teacher. But I have a lousy memory. I have lousy memory.
You already have your own hashtag. We all know Diego.
I mean, I haven't been in the country.
And you know me.
Many, many years.
but when I saw your face, I was like, I feel like I've seen him somewhere.
I know you, Dalia, I know you. I don't remember from where, but.
Okay, so yeah, so it wasn't only me. All right.
No.
We knew each other.
Crazy party.
The funny thing is that I know.
The things that you have to consider when you're talking to your group about next steps is how much time do you have after Unleash to dedicate to the pack? I'm sorry, to dedicate to the idea. What role and responsibilities are you willing to assume in terms of what are you gonna do next and like what can you do for it and what you can't? And then how are you going to work together after this? So are you gonna continue doing it through WhatsApp? Are you gonna establish weekly meetings? Like all of those things are things that you have to consider. Normally we would send you to the breakout rooms, but since the judges are almost coming back, this is something that we encourage you to discuss through the groups that you've already created and through the general WhatsApp group or your internal groups. I know we talked about this a little bit already, just so you have this fresh in your mind. You can email us, the OT members, for a mentorship and any other questions you might have coming forward using the Unleash email. You can go to the Unleash communication channels through the social hub that they sent us. Just because there you're going to have different opportunities come up and different awareness of solutions that you can think of. So it's very important that you keep in touch with the whole Unleash community. Even if you don't have like a follow-up from the Dominican ecosystem partners, you might find international partners that want to help you further your idea. So the Unleash community is very, very important starting tonight and for the rest of the days. And then the methodology is available for future use. So just make sure that you download all the things that we sent on the emails and what you have on your Miro boards and just whatever you find on the social hub and communication tools. And I already talked about the Unleash community platform. And I know they started talking about Unleash Plus. I don't know if they went into that and about what it meant. They did. Karina is like, yes, no.
Yes, Eileen was explaining a bit about
remember you have. Yeah, so just remember you have these available. And this is something cool to think about that in the coming days when they have the new Unleash Plus program, if you need like extra help developing the pitch for funders, that is a great opportunity and something that you should really look forward to. This is what it looks like after tonight. So we'll continue to engage with you after this using the Unleash email. They are going to contact you directly as well. If you win, you have to fill out a series of forms so that we can send you the money and so that we can make sure that you're gonna use the money for the idea. And then you're gonna see when the Unleash Plus program comes up so that you can sign in and well, hopefully your solution gets implemented. Stay in touch, follow us on Instagram if you've founder handles, if you've seen them on the Miro boards, don't hesitate to email and to reach out. And please, please, please complete the post-tax survey. And we have our judges back. Yay.
Is there anything else there, Vivian?
No.
Perfect.
I'm going to stop sharing so that we can.
Magic.
Just in time.
Hello. Yeah.
So welcome back, everyone. We're happy to be here again. We are just waiting to start the presentation just for a second. And this is the moment that we've all waiting for. So can we start the presentation from the beginning, please? Okay, we're all here, so let's just start. Hello, everyone. Good evening. It is our pleasure to have you all here, and we're extremely proud of our Unleash Hacks talents for their hard work and commitment through these two past days. Let me tell you that these young talents have dedicated their time and effort to frame the problems and find solution to one of the biggest issues in the Dominican Republic, waste management. We were focusing on SDG 11 and SDG 12. Our talents presented to our amazing judges their initiative ideas, and today our organizing team feels so honored to announce the winning team and congratulate all the talents for your great work. We are also want to thank to our amazing facilitators and experts for dedicating their time the whole weekend into listening and supporting all the teams and for guiding them through the right path. Let's see if the presentation is playing. There you go. Next slide. So it has been quite a journey, and for us and as an organizing team as former Only Sharon talent, we want to share with you that this experience has been incredible for us, and we really appreciate and we are so very thankful for the support of EcoRed, who has been our co-host partner through all the event by facilitating the tools and platforms we need. We also want to do a very big thank to all our ecosystem partners, IRD, NUBI, UNPDR, Educa, Adiplas, Fundación 3R, Chesspace, Global Shapers, Startup Grinds, and Lady Ones and Designs. Without your support, this event has not been possible. And we also want to thank you, all the talent. This event has been a success because of you. And now we are super proud to present all the judges, and they will start by providing some awards that are gonna be special mentions. So we invite here to Inca from the UNPD. You're in mute, I think. There you go. So you can go up the slide so we can start with the first special mention. Inka, I think you're in mute. There you go.
Okay, here I go. Good night, everyone. Fantastic congratulations for every one of us. Special mention at the fourth place goes to TrustFlow. From UNDP, we will offer you to participate as a sounding board to some of the experiments we are starting in some of the Santo Domingo and Santo Domingo Este communities, exactly to see how to change the behaviors in the local communities. This is work that we are doing through our acceleration lab, which is one of the 78 development innovation labs in the world managed by UNDP. So we really want to continue collaboration with you.
Thank you so much. And we're so proud for receiving, for this team Los Bulsos to receiving this special mention. Now we're gonna go to a second special mention from Tinglar. And for that, we invite Johanna.
Hello. We want to offer, I'm sorry, I think that's mistaken. The mention.
Okay.
It was live. So number one. If this is live, it's okay. I'm sorry. It was directed to team number one. And we want to collaborate with them because they have a very emphatic emphasis on collaborating with local communities and empower them through education. So from Tinglar, we want to help you guys work in this area, and in any way we can mentor you, we are going to do it.
Thank you so much. And sorry about that mistake. We're all
it's okay.
So next slide, please. To announce the third place award, we want to pass to the word to the judges, Jeannie Hansen and Johan Nunez. Both are influential voices on sustainable development in Dominican Republic. We want you, we really thank you for being here. Please make the honors to announce the third place.
Johan, go ahead.
Okay, so it's my honor to announce that the third winners in this beautiful initiative is...
Ta-da!
Ta-da! Paco Pera, congratulations to the third, to team number 10.
And they will be receiving $200. We offer our mentoring. We understand it's very important what you're trying to do, and we want to be part of it. And also, Chess Space is offering a space at their center, a co-working space, or digital, and also being part of the Startup Grind. Golden ticket. Congratulations, number team 10. Sayuris, congratulations.
Congratulations.
Thank you. And I was asking if I can use the mic because I didn't know the logistics. So thank you. We really appreciate this amazing prize and this amazing opportunity to keep working with you guys. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. I'm really happy about it.
Great, and we love to hear from all of you. So now let's go to announce the second place award. And